It's really a pleasure, and I mean this sincerely, and an honor to introduce our 2014-2015 Design of Theory Fellow, Benjamin J. Smith. And it's fantastic to see a lot of familiar faces from SCI-Arc here and COI. thank you, everybody, for joining us. So tonight, it was interesting thinking about, you know, when I was asked to introduce Benjamin, I really had time to consider this word fellow. And what is the fellow, a fellow, a good fellow, a fellow is a guy, a fellow, this is our typical fellow from Oxford in 1910. This is David Lloyd George, who happens to be, he was a former chancellor of the Exchequer. So the conventional idea that comes to mind when one thinks of a fellow, perhaps, is more along the lines of this fellow, who is sort of sitting in his scholarly robes, writing and postulating theory. Fast forward to 2015 at SCI-Arc, and our idea of a fellow, quite a fellow indeed, this is Benjamin introducing, making a kind of small trailer for SCI-Arc Channel for the painter Perry Hall. And it, to me, it exemplifies the spirit of the Design of Theory Fellowship at SCI-Arc, that really this fellowship is and has been, since its recent inception, Benjamin was the second of the fellows, was really focused on the idea of designing theory. So the design of theory as something, rather than theorizing design and seeing those things as two separate endeavors, really about how do we engage as someone who is trained as an architect, as a designer, as Benjamin is. I mean, Benjamin's an alumnus of SCI-Arc, graduated 2007, and is currently pursuing his PhD at the University of Michigan at the Taubman School. And so I think, you know, a couple of the other images I wanted to show were these images of Off-Ramp, which Benjamin, in his capacity as Design of Theory Fellow, was a co-editor of two issues of Off-Ramp. And really looking, again, at how do we produce discourse in a contemporary context, especially in a school like SCI-Arc. How do we think about platforms for communicating ideas that might be deemed theoretical, but how do we make that available to a wider audience? So Benjamin, I think, worked very diligently in terms of both the hand in curating these two issues of Off-Ramp, as well as, you know, really making this come together, you know, really designing the kind of space in which this discourse would live. And so I think really tonight I'm very eager to hear about some of your thoughts on the title of tonight's lecture, Architecture as Conviction, Vapid Potential or Rigorous Consequence. I think some speculations on how expertise and sort of technological progress and sort of advancement, or what we might assume to be advancement, may not be as advanced as one thinks, and how does that kind of require a rethinking of the position of the architect or the position of the designer. So I think Benjamin really does exemplify the spirit of the SCI-Arc, the fellow of today, as opposed to the musty scholarly fellow. I think really the work that Benjamin does, the writing that Benjamin produces, the teaching, while Benjamin was here, also having participated as an instructor in both the 2B and the 1GA studios, and many of you guys who have studied with Benjamin are here today. And so I think that really, I'm very excited about this, how this model of the bringing together of these different endeavors will really impact the, you know, a change in the kind of pedagogical environment. And it's something I think that Benjamin's been looking at in his dissertation research, specifically writing about about SCI-Arc, the history of SCI-Arc, Without Walls, SCI-Arc in Los Angeles Architecture of the 1970s and 1980s, which examines the institutional history of SCI-Arc and the architects who taught there during that time. And I think it's been a really fruitful experience for you to be able to conduct that research while teaching in the current iteration of SCI-Arc. So with that, I would like to welcome Benjamin Smith back to SCI-Arc. Thank you.
Thanks, Marcelin. Let's see, let me get... Is that set up? All right. Great. So thank you for having me here today. I very much appreciate having the opportunity to talk with all of you about some new work that I'm beginning. And I'm also very happy to be able to lecture at SCI-Arc. It's a school that has impacted me tremendously. I attended SCI-Arc for my MArc and was advised by Coy Howard, who in many ways continues to advise me today. It's a school that's the subject of my dissertation research for my PhD at University of Michigan, where my advisor is John McMurrow. My dissertation, which will be completed shortly, focuses on the first 15 years of the school's history, essentially the CAPI era of SCI-Arc. And also, quite recently, it's a school I was fortunate to teach at through a fellowship I had last year that you just heard about. But I really feel that I know SCI-Arc from three very different perspectives, in part due to the varying roles that I've had as a student, a scholar, and a faculty member, but also due to the clear differences of SCI-Arc's identity relative to who is in leadership roles at the school in relation to the context that I was looking at it. These different moments of my intersections with SCI-Arc have shown to me what a special institution it is, and that it promotes a platform that architecture deserves as a place to constantly question and provide critique or alternatives for the direction of the discipline. I hope that my talk today will be constructive for ways to think about engaging practices in our field, to give ideas for architecture some shape, and what I feel is a needed understanding of architecture's consequence. In general, I focus on work impacting trajectories of advanced practices in architecture, with observations embedded in the techniques and sensibilities inherent to architectural production. I see myself as a design theorist who uses design, theory, and history to be articulate with architecture's motivations and its results. Ultimately, I view architecture as an aesthetic practice, which is not only what it looks like, but the combination of attributes that define what it is. My talk today will span four areas. I'll give a brief description of a recent research trajectory. I'll provide an assessment of reality relative to architectural conventions via an architectural trope and vertical circulation. I'll account for ways that architects can utilize spatial and temporal thinking in time-based media and cinema as a mechanism to deliver content for architecture. And lastly, I'll give a 10-minute piece advocating for vulnerability and conviction for architectural practice. Two video installations I made will play in the background. Architecture reveals culture in its various artifacts of production through its effects and how it affects. Architecture must act. It cannot be idle. Architecture puts things into the world, whether they are ideas or forms. Architecture's strengths are in its diverse responses to cultural challenges. Architects must communicate their work effectively. They also need freedom to be creative with their ideas. I value creative discovery and work that develops a clear theoretical premise. A goal I work toward focuses on the clarity of argumentation underlying the apprehension of a subject by considering intentions as the negotiation between aesthetic sensibility and design techniques. Today's talk focuses on one aspect related to a new research project that tackles the evolution of digital tools in architecture over the past 25 years through an analysis of digital renderings, time-based media, 3D prints, and robotics. I will go into depth regarding spatial and temporal qualities in film as a mechanism to reflect on qualities in time-based media for architecture. Recently, research on this broader topic of the digital has grown and includes text by Rivka and Robert Oxman's edited book titled Theories of the Digital in Architecture. Antoine Picon, who I think was recently here, has also written a book titled Digital Culture in Architecture. Greg Lynn curated an exhibition at Yale University with a subsequent catalog titled Archaeology of the Digital. He recently edited Log 36, which focuses on robotics. And Mario Carpo edited an AD reader titled Digital Turn in Architecture, 1992-2012. My research efforts direct investigations into the mastery of technology and its intellectualization. In a contemporary context where the sources for inspiration have never been greater, outcomes from this diversity require theorization. Within an era of post-digital virtuosity, architecture must calibrate the value of its contribution with greater clarity. Beyond latent potential, the polemic for this research observes that these tools deserve methodologies to arrive at results with consequence and asks architecture to contemplate and decide how these tools should be used today. I should mention that these are ideas I've been ruminating on for about 10 years, really since I was a student at SCI-Arc. But it was exactly 1 year ago at the Harry Cobb lecture that I began to think about a framework for developing this topic. The examples I use and analyze are from a diverse past, but to me reveal strategies to engage subjects that can be explored through imagining new value for tools we use and evolve daily. Five themes I'm working on include veridical realisms, which discusses the capacity for visualization tools to reveal architectural truths. Second is techno-wabi-sabi, which conveys a strategy for materiality with feeling and emotion, challenging the exuberance of antiseptic formalism. Third, dynamic spatialization, which will be a focus for today's talk, traces cinematic techniques from filmmakers and ideas from aesthetic philosophy to engage communicative strategies for formal, spatial, and temporal thinking. Fourth is prototyping relationships that rethinks the singular 3D print as a field condition for seeing connections. And fifth, inside thresholds, considers ways to integrate corporeal response through robotics. The goal is to understand how exploring territories that exceed the mastery of digital techniques, we can reimagine the intellect governing digital tools by empowering architects with opportunities to establish new terms for aesthetic and cultural experience in architecture. This research proposes architecture as conviction to seek rigorous ideas for progress that supplant diffuse latency. Instead of doing less with more, innovative alternatives must arrive with lasting consequence. My question for architecture contemplates what should be done when expertise with technology no longer hinders the possibilities of what could be done. Think about the term contingent, a kind of if-then, a state of being where the hypothetical deductive is logically inferable from the antecedent. At the level of experience, can architecture operate at levels of contingency, or can it only operate with a kind of conditional correspondence? With more than one answer, value lies in the form of a provocation. We work with the production of inference, interpretation, intuition, and creativity that happens surrounding moments of perception, and alternatively, bring to consciousness those gaps between moments of perception. These decisions require a particular attention, a scrutinizing of work, a recognition for the way things are, and decisions for how they should be. I like thinking about how architecture makes strides toward advancement. These advancements can be radical, but really, what makes something radical today? with seemingly radical formalisms, radical geometric expressions, radical efforts to use technology inventing the next isms, what has the cultural currency today that situates a radical discourse? And how might that affect our place in the world? My charge argues for each of us to lay claims for what architecture should be if it didn't have to be anything else. One way to be radical recognizes conventions or tropes and nudges them just outside of familiar cultural register, provoking a mild curiosity, an unintended happenstance, something not purposefully confusing, strange, or odd, but yields a subtle shift in perception. I think about past work like Robert Irwin's MoMA installation, one of his scrim works that renegotiated the spatiality of the walls, the light, and the texture of the room, simultaneously dulling a kind of perception but awakening others, a room described by some people as blank or empty, questioning its artness. For Irwin, this critical moment happened for the viewer or experiencer of his work when they recognized a situation as art. This feeling embodied his expression, perceiving yourself perceiving, or what another artist, Olafur Eliasson, has called the introspective quality of seeing. If we can choose how we experience, this creates a seeming paradox in choice, which makes possible a situation with potentially multiple and incompatible experiences with logically consistent observational results. Instances like these allowed the mathematician Henri Poincaré to argue that choices regarding our perception and conceptualization of the world can become a matter of convention. In his example of spatial descriptions on Earth, the geometric spatial structure of Euclidean geometry provides a simpler method than the equally logical spatial structure of non-Euclidean geometry, and therefore Euclidean geometry maintained preference as the appropriate geometric construction to explain the results of observation. With that, a challenge for architecture exposes and/or confounds the qualities of experience. Its task locates how to talk about the consequence, the significance, and the stakes of architecture with particular specificity. One territory that compels me exposes spatial exaggerations or alterations of vertical circulation. If the way I think about this kind of work succeeds experientially, I find it to parallel Borges' short story, Pierre Menard, author of The Quixote, where what seems to be the same performs with radical difference, depending on the quality of experiential recognition. I'm trying to remember what it was like, the first time I was even conscious of moving vertically in space. I remember being carried as a baby up the steps. I couldn't have been more than a year old, but I remember laughing at my grandmother's curly hair bobbing up the stairs. I just remember the rhythm of walking up, the dislocation from one place, arriving somewhere else. We believe in the apparent continuity of consciousness. This appearance of the continuity of consciousness makes us live under the impressions of illusion. I wonder if I'm having more fun in the parts that are unconscious. Through our imaginations, we construct an illusory world based on the fragments of consciousness, a kind of filling in. Alvin Noh describes filling in, his term, as common. He gives the example of looking at a tomato and seeing it as a voluminous solid, which occurs through sensorimotor understanding. His writing suggests that as soon as we name something, like a staircase, as soon as we process the perception cognitively and provide perception with an appearance, we are no longer in the state of perceiving. At that point of cognition, we enter into the state of sensation. Although Noh does write that, quote, "There is no sharp line where your perceptual awareness of something stops and your mere thought awareness of it starts. Thought and experience are, in important ways, continuous." Robert Irwin has also described experience in a similar way, through a six-stage process that he called the process of a compounded abstraction, in seeing is forgetting the name of the thing one sees. That process is perception, conception, form, formful, formal, and formalized. Irwin's point six, formalized, which states, quote, "Standardized measures begin to dictate our behavior, a behavior that has become utterly estranged from direct perceptual experience," end quote. This operates as a location of convention, the location of an architectural trope that we can recognize and work with. For example, I react and relate to Wolfgang Leib's beeswax ziggurat because I see and experience that from the cultural position of what it means to move up a staircase. I do not see that form without seeing or knowing the concept staircase. We experience these moments like Leib's ziggurat through a conditioned understanding of what it means to experience something. Can we get back to the raw feeling of perception? Pulled different lengths, heights shifting imperceptibly, but shifting nonetheless, subtle transitions, lengthening strides, changing the pace, cadence, breaking the rhythm, plastic experience. We construct an illusion of life with only tiny bits of information. Those illusions are simple, not grandiose visions, but simple constructions of our minds that generate moment to moment. We can ask, are you seeing what I'm seeing? I think we are hardwired the same, but the way experience evolves in each one of us depends on the relationship between our perceptions and our conceptions. I disagree with no man is an island, but I don't think we are brains in a vat either. I think we are part of the archipelago. We mutually construct ourselves relative to our contexts, which we share with each other, and the things that occupy a presence in those contexts. That presence can be material and perceived, or imagined and conceived. I was in a virtual reality environment, the cave. It created an illusion with technology. It excited me the way that Sega's 1991 holographic video game Time Traveler excited me. It didn't. In its experiential present, I wore some gear in a room. However, in my memory, I walked up a staircase and moved my position in space vertically. What began as, wow, huh, became, huh, wow. Alternatively, an experience I had at the Seattle Public Library exposed me to the physical power of architecture. If you have been there and you can recall the stacks and how they are arranged amid a gently sloping surface, running along their perimeter, walking and looking, I suddenly realized I had moved two stories below where I started without noticing a vertical displacement in space at all. So what makes something real? My memory of moving vertically when I never left a stationary horizontal plane in the virtual environment, or having no memory of vertical displacement but absolutely transitioning sectionally in a building. These moments I find very curious in architecture and relate to my reading of Wittgenstein in Philosophical Investigations when he wrote about the value of intermediate cases and the importance of seeing connections. It becomes too simple to say what was and what wasn't real. Experiences are malleable. Architecture assists conscious and unconscious experiences with reality. The philosopher Hegel claimed that not all things are possible in all media, meaning that each media, painting, film, architecture, poetry, sculpture, etc., do different things aesthetically and intellectually, a kind of filling out of experience through difference. Worn, smooth surfaces, Parisian marble, the appearance of time's physiognomy, step, 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 slide across the surface, light hitting fenestration, mapping it onto the floor, and the dark walk down to take out the trash. Hard surfaces, red lacquer, dark stains, displaced textures, some fuzzy, scuffed from use. The use of time-based media remains a convention of representation in our field, one that I still find offers aesthetic and technical achievement. As a student, the fly-through operated as a pervasive technique at many reviews and in many architectural practices, oftentimes scored with the latest underground ambient track. Animations and films by architects evolved with greater rigor relative to the narrative structure or the facility to communicate complex ideas. However, the fly-through maintains its presence that feels limited in its format for architectural expression. I'll present examples from architecture and cinema revealing techniques that shape their efficacy. I remember two distinct instances thinking about this in the mid-2000s. The first occurred at a lecture that I saw here by the creative director of Imaginary Forces, Peter Frankfurt. Frankfurt discussed the production of title sequences and trailers through his work on films like Seven and Transformers. Frankfurt described in their conceptualization of their title sequence for Seven, stitching together fragments of imagery that identified with the unease of the film's content. The choppy imagery felt dirty. The sense of repulsion toward the sequence became easy as you entered into the madness of a psychopath, effectively scored with Trent Reznor's track Closer. I realized at that moment the architectural fly-through underperformed by comparison, and I wanted to think about cinematic techniques to reveal the sensibility and conceptual underpinnings of architectural projects in a similar way, like a trailer or a title sequence does. I also believe in the value of designing the audio track for the animation or film rather than using a de facto track from an album or a known source. By doing this, the designer curates their work with greater aesthetic attention to qualities necessary for proper reception. Around 2007, I saw a particularly cliche animation for a project in Chicago, Santiago Calatrava's Spire Tower. I'll play a short segment of it here. So the animation uses a convoluted camera path. Somehow it blasts through the facade to get to the interior. And as tour guides, it uses a dove, a droplet, and a floating seed pod, which relay cliched tropes to communicate the building's character. A non-architect who I showed this to humorously commented it would have been better if it had been scored with Prince's track, When Doves Cry. To me, this exemplifies an apotheosis of a missed opportunity in architectural animation through the use of the architectural fly-through. The animation, created as an advertisement for an audience outside progressive sensibilities of the avant-garde, made me think how much more effectively a practice like imaginary forces used ultimately the same medium, also for a public audience, with much greater aesthetic effect. Clearly, the tone of the two projects are radically different. But it struck me how limited architects were if we didn't push the technology and the creative opportunities within a medium to drive a wholly new understanding of the work that exceeded and complemented other forms of communication, such as drawings and renderings. The staleness of the Calatrava animation bothered me. It reduced the medium to a not-so-valuable display of rendering, albeit in four dimensions, but it didn't take advantage of the medium's aesthetic properties. If not all things are possible in a given medium, the animation or cinematic representation of architecture requires its own strategies for affect. In Erwin Panofsky's 1960 text, Style and Medium in the Motion Pictures, he laid out two terms that I think architects should capitalize on relative to their understanding of producing mediated work or using time-based media. They are the dynamization of space and the spatialization of time. On one hand, that means camera actions make space dynamic, and alternatively, it also means actions occurring in space render time visually. This simple conceptual framework exposes latent consequences for architectural description to reveal qualities and attitudes. I generally see the use of time-based media for architecture in four ways. Unfortunately, I don't have the animation of this project, but it's not on their website anymore, but this is a big project. And it was a line-based animation, but anyways. The first is a representational sequence that describes processes, formal development, and articulation of the decision-making process with respect to a project through information. So a didactic animated representation of Bygg's government building project for Norway developed by reading sight lines and code restrictions. This diagrammatic representation animated a slideshow of line drawings to demonstrate the inevitability of building forms based on analysis. The analysis suggested appropriate results from a set of parameters determining forms with prosaic absolutism, and in essence, literalizing the diagram. Second, they can also be trailers, which use similar conventions as short films to establish a project's narrative context. They give a sense of how that context progresses. They also reveal a motive by making value evident based on the organization of visual content. A short film by Waitt, or W-A-I-T-T, I'm not sure how to pronounce the name, shows a product, a lamp, through advertising and uses a combination of techniques including stop motion, attention to precise positioning of the object relative to its material properties within a context, as well as using the audio track to portray the object's demeanor by the way motion occurs in relation to the music. These effects convey a playful attitude about the product in addition to revealing qualitative properties evoking a refined formal sensibility. The third type is short films that convey a narrative structure and situate a project's aesthetic qualities, whether virtual or actual, through intellectual content conveying knowledge or criticism or content with feeling and emotion. An animation from Moss, it's a long animation, The Romance of Systems demonstrates an intellectually driven short film. The dialogue conveyed through text illustrates a disciplinary motive for the project. Its consistent use of the slow pan carries the story forward, revealing an esoteric building given articulation by subtle transitions in lighting. The camera's action becomes tedious and mirrors characters in the story who grow restless, arguing about architecture's debates on form and content. The viewer must reconcile whether or not the building performs at the level of pragmatism or excess. The repetitive framing exposes as much as it annoys, but reinforces the storyline with idiosyncratic irony. The conventions they use carry the short film's motive for disciplinary critique. Fortunately, not long enough to get to the building part. The fourth type of video installation I will address in the last part of my talk. The kinds of time-based products that interest me for architecture tend to be conceived as trailers, short films, or video installations because they offer greater opportunities to affect their audience relative to a context of thinking that the designer feels essential. I also see them functioning parallel to buildings or other types of installations operating as autonomous aesthetic expressions. The context for the narrative depends on what qualities the designer determines appropriate for a particular project. Being a formalist in nature, I argue for narratives that develop positions surrounding formal significance and experience. To describe formal content, how a narrative progresses, I believe would need to show how the properties of the form speak with emotional impact. I do not mean they need to make me happy or sad, but that they articulate a particular disposition or quality that compels interpretations so that the mediation through time achieves dramatized qualities with at least a minimum of abstract recognition. I base this interest in part on my reading of Clive Bell's text, The Aesthetic Hypothesis, where he advocates for significant form. Bell stated that significant form stands charged with power to provoke aesthetic emotion in anyone capable of feeling it. That was a quote. He asserts that recognition, quote, carries a person who is capable of appreciating it out of life into ecstasy, end quote. And that beyond representation, significant forms yield a sense of form, color, and three-dimensional space to, quote, recognize a range. rightfully do on their own. It does not mean that static images or objects cannot convey a significant form, far from it, but only to say that film offers a way to convey a significant form differently. When a designer creates mediated sequences, they should be clear with their reasons for why they make them, so an audience appreciates the aesthetic effects of a project. The use of time-based media depends on the audience or the context to make decisions regarding presentation. That means, is the work for a mass public a professional project or to give directions for disciplinary advancement? Thinking about the audience also means considering if the work refers to the profession or for academia. For example, in a building project in an office, I might think about advertisements and showing a balance between needs and desires for an actual program or type. For a theoretical project, I might push qualities of desire over need, tending to advocate for virtual domains using qualities of abstraction for an installation. And for student projects, I would listen by guiding a project's development without autocratic instruction, working to expose a student to the impact of decisions they want to make by assisting them to critically interrogate their ideas with respect to a medium and a project's intentions. If we resist the conceptual aptitude of a medium, we miss out on its effective consequence. By consequence, I mean that decisions made within a work contribute to its power to deliver aesthetic impact. Aesthetic impact, to me, is an essential trait in designed work and drives a person's reaction to it. Of course, impact occurs with great difference from person to person, but these decisions set up the condition to make a reaction possible at all, even if it is dismissal. I'll now turn my discussion to qualities within cinema as a means to reflect on conceptual frameworks that can impact architectural uses of time-based media. The power of film captivates its viewers. We've all experienced the theater become dark, where everyone grows quiet. Light and sound permeate the space, and we slip into a new world with its own logic and pre-established course of events. We wander along with and share the excitement, depravity, and humor that unfolds before us. In the environment of film, we can let ourselves go, giving into its unique flows and durations. Colin McGinn offered one explanation for how we know to do that. McGinn claims that dreaming conditions and prepares the mind for cinematic experience. Moreover, the mental state of dreaming, a composition of thoughts, establishes an analog to the mental state of viewing film. The emotional content produced in a dream parallels the affective sensorial-driven content in a film. In a dream, we react to the sensorial. We feel and are impacted by the images and the sounds that are there. Sensations and emotions fuse as events transpire in the dreams and in the films. In the case of dreams, the events relate deeply and bear significance to the dreamer exclusively. In essence, the dreamer stars in his or her own film. In the case of film, the events become personal through the communication and evocation of aspects resonating with our humanity, aided by a soundtrack. However, in both dreams and films, how they feel relies on contingencies with our relationship to the content depicted. To ascertain the emotional content of a film, we identify with the situation, at least abstractly, to share in its meaning. Meaning in dreams may share common universal themes from person to person, heightening anxiety and terror, as in the case of your mother dying, or pleasure and serenity in cases of love. Regardless, dreams rely on an idiosyncratic relationship to the events that determine content's meaning. McGinn refers to an alarming realization of this, which he calls the ordinariness of dreaming. One aesthetic technique exposed through constructions in dreams, films, and even architectural representations demonstrate examples of spatio-temporal discontinuity to develop or change the expression of ideas. Films and dreams jump from location to location and from time to time, creating disjunctive sensorial information sets. In one moment, I could be dreaming that I'm lying on the beach in Santa Monica, and in the next moment in the dream, I could be swimming in the water. This same kind of sequencing happens within film. This common technique communicates understandably to an audience. This technique, called the cut, gives us fragments of information. Our imagination fills in the gaps to give the montage of fragments coherence. A similar technique in comic books uses the gutter, the spaces between the frames of images. with cuts and with gutters, the narrative, structured in many ways, dislocates from a continuity of progression. These qualities parallel the coordination of drawings in an architectural project. Infinite experiential possibilities within spatiotemporal discontinuity range with complexity and sensation. By engaging our attention to go where films go, we connect to them as active travelers along for the ride. This simple realization can be useful for architects who present time-based work. The audience enters the world of their project. Effective design strategies keep them there. While dreams exist without control of their trajectory or their result, the filmmaker and the architect command what they make, revealing the power of a medium to direct imaginations through perceptual content. Like the Bank of England drawing by John Soane and Joseph Gandhi that projected the future ruination of an unbuilt bank, or Piranesi's Carceri that demonstrated impossible spatial scenarios that could only exist within the imaginative context of the drawing. It is not enough that we can show a glimmering facade or an unusual form whizzing around the screen animated by a camera path. To be more effective, direct the tools to present ideas that show precise calibrations of the medium, thinking about sequences, framing, camera angles, and dramatic lighting to convey emotional impact, as well as hitting the right note as an action occurs, establishing narrative. These relational organizations offer ways to communicate with significance. Film reveals physiognomic presence through its ability to craft perceptual and conceptual experience through image and sound. Those qualities occur through the motion of the camera while it zooms in or away from a shot, while simultaneously panning or tracking toward or away from a scene. It also occurs when the shot cuts from a close-up to a distant view. From a camera seeking information, a good film satisfies our imaginations by what it exposes. The micro-universe of a film paints a picture not unlike the reality of physical experience in real space, using fragments for conscious perception to construct a clear picture of the reality appearing before us. We construct in our minds something logical and believable relative to what we experience. The structure of a film for architecture likely delivers different kinds of ideas than cinema, but should consider what structure or methodology it uses to make ideas within a project clear or adds to other media shown in conjunction with it, essentially answering why time-based media necessitates its presence by revealing something for its audience that cannot be depicted in drawings, models, or renderings. In an episode of the animated television show American Dad, a scene with an alien named Roger shows him faking his own death in a bloody series of events involving a bus in front of his boyfriend. Later, his friend Stan asks him how he could do that. Roger modestly explains that he can move really fast. When Roger explains what happened, events presented to the viewer reveal a set of images that we could never experience in day-to-day reality. The sequence becomes possible because of Roger's alien powers and the illusion created by film through animation. In this flashback, we see that in the instant before the truck hits what seems to be Roger, he found a crowbar, pried open a manhole cover, pulled out a dummy body and supplies for the appearance of blood and guts, answered a text from Bob Saget, smeared the fake blood on the dummy, closed the manhole cover, and jumped onto the far side of the bus for a getaway. It's fantastic, it's absurd, and utterly believable in the context of the animation, and presents likewise believability if a similar thematic occurred in a film with characters. Films like The Matrix, Jumper, Looper also use these kinds of techniques with different affect, exposing what our imaginations accept in the context of mediated alternative realities. Chris Marker's La Jetée demonstrates a film with split spaces and times. In La Jetée, the primary character of the film, the man, learns as the viewers learn that the death he witnessed from his childhood, a death that the viewers remember from an earlier scene, was the man's own death as an adult who had time-traveled into his own past to save the present from which he came. Film renders this extremely complicated set of thoughts clearly. Another example of this kind of discontinuity is seen in Christopher Nolan's film Memento, which reverses the temporal order of its scenes. The film begins with the conclusion from the chronology of the main character, Lenny. As the film proceeds and the viewer's present, the character's chronology moves in reverse, exposing the events that led up to the already viewed conclusion. Nolan further enriches the temporality of the film by creating two distinct temporalities within it, differentiated by color and black and white sequences. The color sequences move the story along in reverse, whereas the black and white sequences move time forward for the characters. Just by modifying colors, the viewer apprehends significant conceptual differences relative to the author's intent. David Lynch's film, Mulholland Drive, also presents extreme spatial and temporal complexity. In one interpretation, the first two-thirds of the film depict the point of view of the character Diane Selwyn dreaming she is someone else, Betty Elms. In this portion of the film, characters and situations conspire with the structure and narrative of her dream. The final third of Mulholland Drive shows a narrative outside of the dream and takes place in Diane's awake reality. In this awake reality, most of the characters from the dream remain present, but their personalities, relationships, and histories differ from those within her dream. The ability to convey a strategy for a protagonist's changing relationship to their context, whether a character or an architectural form, reveals a subject's inherent concepts. Tarkovsky's film Solaris presents a complicated web of situations, both material and psychological, that make it a fascinating case study for experience and representation. A critical plot development, told through the experiences of the protagonist, Chris Kelvin, reveals Solaris's ability to peel away and materialize artifacts from a person's past, whether those artifacts be memories, wishes, or fears that reside within the conscious and subconscious self. In the opening scenes on Earth, Tarkovsky saturates the film with resplendent nature. These shots characterize Tarkovsky's classic examples of long takes, which allow the scenes to dramatize the story through material development and time. Through time, the character of the space emerges. In these examples, Tarkovsky shows grasses swaying in the moving water, and dark green trees and thick foliage, steam rising off the pond, and the first shot of Chris standing among it all, within it, part of the landscape. The sequence's dense imagery promotes a strong sense of atmosphere before Kelvin uttered a word. This may sound similar to the Calatrava animation with its own infusions of nature relative to its protagonist, the building, but Tarkovsky uses filmic conventions of framing, cuts between scenes, and dramatic lighting, underscoring what Panofsky described as the dynamization of space and the spatialization of time, to connect the character deeply to his context, and so the audience. In a particularly effective scene, Chris sits on the upstairs balcony near a set table in the rain. On the table, a cup of coffee in the rain illustrates the strangeness of the scene, suggesting a relationship between the scene's elements. Differences merge, fusing one to the other, making it difficult to imagine the separation of the rainwater from the coffee and the cup, and making it difficult to see Kelvin independent from the rain. This tactic conveys a technique for articulating and merging differences, things architecture does readily, such as impressions from and on a site, as well as how forms develop or modulate, or the ways programs blend or differentiate. Before Kelvin leaves for Solaris, he symbolically burns his belongings, but he cannot leave behind himself and his memories. When Chris makes contact with the atmosphere of Solaris, he experiences a visitor, a manifestation from his subconscious representing his wife who died 10 years ago. A significant scene occurs when Chris's representation sits at a table smoking, having the appearance of wanting to know what it means to be human while she gazes at Bruegel's painting, The Hunters in the Snow, searching for clues within the canvas. Chris's manifestation is a one-to-one representation of his wife, signifying a simulacra. Chris's representation mirrors the dual role of the paintings, but begins to exceed them. The Hunters in the Snow, from Bruegel's series called The Cycles, depict 2 months of the year in 6 panels, constructed artifacts. In this moment, Chris's representation, puzzled by her nature of being, appears to be asking, am I representation or am I something else? The paintings depict a quality of representation through brushstroke, a symbol of the painter's intentions manifested materially, a direct parallel to the scientist's materialized representations on the space station. The paintings also approximate time capsules of memory, for the scientists to remember Earth and their own humanity. This complex filmic sequence reveals important qualities about representation. First, it shows, through cinematic techniques and character development, how representations gain ontological status as real things. Secondly, it gives the audience cultural cues to arrive at a concept, representation. To me, we wrestle with how to explain the power of representation in architecture all the time. Decisions funnel like a kaleidoscope, a gaze often revealing more than it focuses. Architects try clarity to something. As they try to understand more about it, as they work to give it definition, ideas cascade, increasing the range of their focus. The structure of cinema provides ways to articulate thoughts about subjects that escape verbalization or the expression within a singular image, opening up how designers relate esoteric themes within their work to an audience. As viewers of such situations, we can question the reality of the contexts we inhabit and perceive. We can ask, do we see the same thing? Are we constructing everything that we are part of? Or how does our location relative to something else establish a mutual construction? Also, acknowledging the presence of representations to reshape a context demonstrates intersections between materiality and concepts. In Solaris and in architecture, the residue of memory achieves physical form, creations from imaginations culled from a repository of experience. Film controls what we perceive and the rate at which we perceive it. It does not raise the amount of what we perceive, but negotiates the way we encounter what we become aware of. It gives us access to transitions through experience. In a constructed temporality of events, independent from what we experience in physical reality. Instead of being jarring, cinema renders confounding experiences with ease, aestheticizing them with plausible clarity. I am not suggesting that architects create two-hour films with a cast to describe an architectural project. I am suggesting that architects analyze films for techniques that reveal spatial, formal, and cultural qualities to capitalize on for 90-second to 3-minute trailers, short films, or animations. Within film trailers alone, they effectively convey what the subject matter is and the context of the film. Trailers also demonstrate a methodology for how the content of the film progresses or develops. A third aspect that successful trailers demonstrate is relevance. Not only do they signify how film advances its subject matter, they also, somehow, convince a lot of people to give $15 and 2 hours of their time to watch them. In the medium of film, its immediacy parallels our reality of the physical present, but its malleability bends the substance of reality. Architecture also offers ways to shape the reality of experience. Film and architectural representation facilitate the preconditioning of experience, conveying opportunities to focus attention. In film and architecture, representation compels an aesthetic negotiation. The physicality of the representation engages the present by existing parallel to it. Film and architecture explain predilections for experience and deliver tools to shape imaginations. Architects create scenarios for cultural progress, challenging and exposing alternatives to day-to-day realities. Architecture relies on conventions of experience to transcend what those conventions are, attempting to make alternatives for contemporary culture. The use of time-based media should inspire architecture through provocations, developments, and comments for experience. As architects adopt and evolve tools and technologies, they need to know why they bring value to their ideas. I imagine the architect's distinct skills in 3D visualization will impact strategies for imagining virtual reality environments. By incorporating a command of three-dimensional understanding with cinematic techniques, robotics, and rapid prototyping, architects should pioneer fields using time-based medium and virtual reality as experts who give it definition. More than buildings and more than moving images, architecture conditions culture to engage media that comment on reality. (Clears throat) Okay, so this is the last part. And before I begin this last part, I just want to explain the two video installations that you'll be looking at to give you a sense of what you're looking at and why I made them. But the first installation, which will be on your left, used the phenomena of audio and video feedback loops, though you will not hear the audio from the installation. I first became aware of video feedback from one of my SCI-Arc classmates, actually, Steve Kim, who had explored it in a studio that we were in together. But my primary interest was not in the loop itself, but to produce an interactive experience with the video medium. So using video feedback for an interactive installation, I created a place where the spectator took on a reciprocal relationship with the space they occupied, raising the degree to which someone becomes aware of their participation with an environment. The user of the installation learned to play with light and space in an act of mutual co-production. The second installation, which will be on your right, considered its relationship within an environment, negotiating time, space, movement, and occupancy as well. This installation coupled performance with being site-specific. The project overlaid video into a context, simulating the pre-recorded video to exaggerate and dismantle preconceptions of use and identity. Themes explored included gender, replication, presence, and again, the use of light and space to affect participation. Designing things, thinking things, theories, ideas, words, objects, catapulting across the discipline. Ricochet here, there, see this new, look here, look there, linger, loiter with attention. Considerations matter, nuances are an important negotiation. Design, what does it rely on for validation? Cynics, champions of design, what validation? Resist, move forward, make, use it creatively, finding balance between this and that, here and there, then and now. Design, a promise through producing something new. Shapes in experience, rubbing onto my skin, into my intellect, these forms, to be wise, patinating, resonating. The use of worn feelings, being handled and cared for, objects looking this way, thinking about them, touching them with imagination, seeing, caressing the forms, slide across the surface, sinking into the composition, part of it, its structure, reaching out, rotating, turn to face it, orbit, zoom, lock on, land, hover, grazing, chewing, ruminating, the grit of sandpaper, the smell of oil, staining a surface, chemicals stinging and linking, forming of something to something else, the metamorphosis, a chrysalis, crash, jolting forward, positioning for leverage, make a claim, visual, verbal, vulnerable, not invisible. Which goal design? Better buildings, better ideas, better knowledge, better feeling? Choose. Choose it believing, make decisions, act, not passive, design does, put into the world, a consequence, never perfect, never an observer, an attempt to do, something, listening, making, fresh, failing, working, taking, care for it. Caring and making, make it just this way from these decisions, from these feelings, defensible appearance, the reception, expanding vocabularies for visual description, seeing more, unknowing, making without thinking to know, articulating impressions barely recognized, fine lithographs pressed onto nerve endings, twitching on the periphery, come into focus, see, be seen, these things, objects, stretching means, landscapes floating across corneas into fingertips, into meaning, resonating, reciprocating, cyclical intoxication, in, out, back and forth, participating. This is, you are part of the negotiation at the threshold between irreverence and speculation, between the firmament and the wonder, between the tangible actual, manifesting the intellectual, calling it out, what new other, pushing between, straddling conventions, this new ecstasy, this swagger, finding the new, the next place, to be excited, to feel uncomfortable, get there, surrender. Known, unknown, unknowable, whichever, no matter, facts and idiosyncratic sensation commingle at the margins of understanding, making experience malleable by exceeding obstacles, leaving behind discrete boundaries with alternative directions for progress. Fragments become knowing, assembled, regarded, new negotiations compounding abstraction, reality at one moment, contingent relationships not based on logical necessity, things intransitive with formal definition. Performing in being, composition, representation, indefinite purpose, remaining in reconciliation, significant in consideration, simultaneity of contrast, creating productive tension, challenging, understanding, manifold configurations, charging engagement, looking to be reciprocal, long takes, evolving looking, seeing the impurity of definite resolution, excitement without answers, reconciling glimpses, making total constructions for completion, new holes, suggesting new abstractions, implicating audiences, compelled to meander, enlivening, innate, innovative, means for exceeding the contemporary, challenging boundaries, resisting stagnation, a new narrative, compositions with gutters to fill, onto original thinking, arriving at new conclusions, bold, experiments for figuring, work, testaments of learning, bringing an aesthetic laden with feeling, resisting distinctions, leaning toward tomorrow, knowledge mattering, reach past, scaling, calibrating, spacing, forming, blurring, reading qualities to signify works, challenging assumptions, offering alternatives, consideration, nuance, negotiation, without history for validation, produce something new for time, for type, push, pushing forward, guiding perception and imagination without limits, growing experience, finding extents, aesthetic significance, of architecture, of art, of culture, in time, in distinct natures, attributes of form, design, buckling, finding, delighting, great works, changing, melding into others, forming concatenations for expression, intelligence through them, great precision to give feeling, new making, standing among the rest, giving expression, creating, not fictions, not illusions, not an explanation, not extraneous details, other opportunities to feel, making possible this feeling here to be captured without memory, without history, exceeding limits of detail, without loss, capable abstraction, penetrating, endless, now, without distracting, for rumination, for speculation, free, freeing, to claw back, reflect, direct. In a world of certainty, we stop perceiving, a convenience denying difference, convincing tricks to believe encounters, natures, unnatural, distorting truths, cognition, sensation, continuous. This quotidian generalities relied on to buy tomatoes, to explain the weather, to drive on the interstate. Creativity holds up alternatives, looks into them, looks past them, looks long and through, get there, venture, adventure, switch on understanding, locate appearances, differences, identify forms in experience, like tomatoes, like staircases, place them adjacent to uncertain forms without proper terms or names. Extend the inability to commit to a resolvable and identifiable object, finding curiosity within the doubleness of experience for forms, for objects, for ideas, alternating in magnitudes, in intensities, trembling, macho, put elements of experience into tension, vacillate, believing creative resolution, utilize fragments of information, keep experience malleable, becoming too simple to say that something isn't this, to say that something is this. Seek out divergence from perspicuous representations. See connections, understand, invent new cases, intermediate cases, inherent to experience, expanding what is possible, abstraction, reality, compounded at one moment. Create alternatives, contingencies, truths, things, intransitive, achieve formal definition, value, characterized by composition and configuration, willingness to participate. What engagement with experience initiates ambiguity, the opposite of a compass, just as precise, an immediate presence of difference, trespass into novelty, lead toward the unorthodox, the nascent territories of experience, make feeling alive in work, seeking relationships, metaphors, similes, make them, get them to play, these games, games in forms, games in words, literal, with tangible aspects, not derivative, games for escape, for fantasy, invigorating, real, climb, inscribing with history, reaching, what legacy, which today, caring, speaking from creative impulse, bursting as the daylilies do that bloom for one day, mixture of essences, growing amidst the scent of wilting peonies, color, form, texture, tomorrow they die. What shows the way they show? So much, not enough, exploding, gone, worn, used, energy releasing, staining, feeling. This, the ability, creating belief, initiating willingness toward the exploration, what feels appropriate in the face of skepticism, lifting formal expectation, seducing, entrance into a world of new relationships. Get there, be vulnerable, be on fire, let failure happen, but use it. Use it to take the next step towards something. The precipice is always there, guiding and negotiating. Look longer and longer, knowing freely, with grace, without, challenge reality, realize joy. Thanks. So I'm happy to take any questions if anybody's got anything to ask.
Thanks,
Ben. The theme continues.
It does, indeed. That was really interesting, Ben. So from what I can tell, you're presenting film as a metaphor for designers. And so there's some question there about where exactly does film find its most currency within the design process, whether it's site analysis or design development or presentation. But I don't want to ask that question. I want to ask a different one, which is whether or not you've allowed this research on film to inflect back on your work as a historian.
Does it
change the way you approach your dissertation, for instance?
My dissertation? That old gadfly. No, I don't know. I mean, I think dissertation. I mean, I have been interested in cinema and film for a long time, and it's been something that's always sort of inflected a lot of the way I think. In regard to the dissertation, I'd say it doesn't really change much in that content, you know? But I'm sure it's like had a residue of influence in the way that I think about architecture, for instance.
Sure. But is that an interesting question to you at all? Like to say memento say, can you write a history like
this? Oh, yeah, right. I see what you're saying. Yeah, so like thinking about kind of reconstructing a history for oneself relative to the tattoos of Lenny and Memento. I think that's super fascinating. I mean, I describe Lenny's tattoos as literal metaphors. So I've been trying to work on a theory for that for a while, and it's a pretty bad one. But I mean, basically, the thinking is that it stands for something that it's not, yet it has direct resonance with the way that he constructs his identity within the world. And to me, there's something really profound with that realization for him in that context. And I guess I would say that history can operate like that. It doesn't always. Should it or shouldn't it? I don't think that's really the. Well, I guess that is a question I would be asking what it should do, but I would be interested in a history that did that.
Yeah. Hey, Benjamin, thank you. You open a lot of doors and trace a lot of threads, and I'm going to only pick on a few or maybe one. One early on came up was the question of normativity and tropes and conventions.
Sure.
And I'm interested in if you think architecture is capable of changing values. I say that kind of rhetorically, but also in the sense that I get suspicious whenever I hear of architecture being given too much agency, that it can do too much in the world. I don't think it can. I think it has a limited capacity and what it can do. And so if we're making the analogy to time-based media and film, and you're saying like, okay, trailers or the opening vignette with Atticus Ross and Trent Reznor at the beginning of Seven, it's like, okay, it's appealing to senses, it's appealing to the acoustic, it's appealing to the perceptual.
Yeah.
But architecture, we have the haptic, we have the tactile, right?
And yeah,
so
of course.
I think like so much of like, if you answer yes, that architecture is capable of transmuting values and is capable of has the agency of transforming values in how we experience the world and each other, then I think it's at the potential that it does it at the level of habit and habituation. And those habits, like how I open a door, how I open my car, how I brush my teeth or floss, these things happen in a they're micro and they're not noticeable, but those are the big things that actually change how we behave in the world. Mm-hmm. And it's not the like the monumental or the big or the grandiose. So I don't know, I want you to speak a little bit about how much agency you think architecture does have, can have, because you're talking about the should, you're talking about the normative. How much agency architecture can have in changing how we behave in the world vis-a-vis the built environment and each other?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I mean, can the conventions of architecture change its value systems? Can it, value systems of experience? That's sort of that's one of the ways that I'm interpreting your question. I would say absolutely. I mean, in the simple sense of, I don't know. I mean, I think architecture has a lot of agency. And I guess, like, you know, as I'm walking around my apartment or my house or whatever, I don't always think architecture is shaping my reality. But I think when I reflect on, significant moments of contact, when I would define them as being architectural, like the memory of the virtual reality environment of going up the stairs, to me that's an absolutely significant moment of architectural experience, and it's profound to me. Like, just the simple act of moving vertically in space is profound enough, but the memory of having stayed stationary on a horizontal plane to me is alarming. And similarly with the experience I described in the Seattle Public Library, in the reverse effect, I think, like, the way that we game with the conventions of architecture makes it have those moments of clarity and resonance with how we are in the world, and I like that. And I think the more that we can trigger those kinds of instances, the more powerful it is. And it's not like you couldn't do it, like, every moment would have to be like that. Then it wouldn't do it anymore. You'd just be in, like, a soup or something that wouldn't really be transmissible. But I think it needs to be carefully orchestrated and organized so that, you know, the way that you circulate through something, there are these moments or these triggers that give you those glimpses into something bigger than what we, you know, would sort of normatively just walk down a hall in. I mean, there's an example that I like a lot, and you've mentioned opening doors, and one example I really like is there was an artist for the London Olympics who just resized a bunch of doorknobs, you know, just big enough where you had to use, like, two hands to open them. I love that. Like, that's not distinctly an architectural convention necessarily, but, like, to me that's like, okay, that gives me something to work with, and it's deployed in an urban context, and I don't know, it would be fun for me to experience something like that, and it would also bring community into a city, frankly.
I was wondering if you could talk for a minute or two about the difference between presentation and representation.
Yeah.
And then what your position is, I mean, in this presentation for architecture and entertainment.
Yeah, of course, okay. Yeah, that's a great question. And I think, like, hopefully that came out that those are two qualities that I'm really fascinated in, both for architecture and, like, just in at large. But, I mean, I think presentation and representation is a choice. So, like, I think that if we choose to be representational, that's existing in service of being referent to something other than it, something that it's not. If you choose a presentation mode of wanting to create a work with its own sort of aesthetic expression, with its own sort of autonomy, that's a different strategy of communicating your work, I think. So the way that I've outlined the four cases of film, I would say that the first two tend to operate towards aspects of representation, meaning if you're going to take, like, a kind of a didactic approach to an animated sequence of diagrams, to me that's a representational strategy to convey a certain kind of significance or meaning relative to how you achieved the form, let's say. Or you could work on a trailer. You know, I think a trailer also operates with aspects of representation in mind. It doesn't tend to stand on its own as a thing, but it communicates a set of events for something that it isn't. And then the last two, a short film, so the example of Moss that I gave, Meredith and Sample, I think that operates as something autonomous, independent from the building that it's depicting in the sequence. And then last is a video or film installation, which I think fundamentally operates as something that is independent from representation in the way that I would conceive it, by being something that's either site-specific or something that can travel, but it maintains a sort of awareness of its own status of being independent from being a building or something else.
The architect's attempt to exceed his own volition. So he looks to outside themes like God, data-driven design, sensation, and you're talking about the narrative and these kind of more like Walter Benjamin is talking about like the immediacy of film. So this kind of like role of authorship seems to come in, like Liam Young's studio and his use of the narrative, telling stories to kind of represent architecture in a different way. What's your attitude towards this effort towards a non-authored architectural project versus, I guess if you call it an authored architectural one?
I would always argue for an authored architectural project. Like, I like the idea of the designer controlling what they're after and being responsible for curating a context of ambitions that reveal what their interests or desires are for a work. So the way that I think about narrative, I guess, is in two ways. So one, I mean it quite literally, like how you convey a story of something. On another hand, I think of narrative as being something that allows you to structure an idea. So like, if I'm talking about the color red, how would I structure a sequence of events that would display or make that evident to its audience? Does that make sense?
Distinguish between art and architecture, if there's even much of a distinction now?
Well, I mean, I guess you'd want to, like, I like Hegel, like when he says, not all things are possible in all media. So that means that each of these mediated artistic expressions have different value structures or different things in place that communicate what they are and how they are in the world. So I guess to me it would be, like, I'm not that finicky about, like, saying what is and what isn't architecture, although, well, I guess sometimes I am, but
I guess my question would be, how do you qualify that?
Oh, how do I qualify architecture versus art? Well, okay, so like Daniel Libeskind's Micromegas, let's say, I've heard those described as art projects.
Yeah.
I find that ludicrous. I think because those communicate through a very clear set of conventions that we've adopted within our discipline, we see those things very clearly relative to how we've come to understand the things that we work on.
Chamber works as well? Do you see it the same way?
Again, like, because, so there's another line of thinking that says what we know about something matters to our experience of it. And I would say knowing that Daniel Libeskind is an architect, trained as an architect, influenced by musical scores and traditions, I see it as a confluence of those kinds of ideas coursing through the work in Chamberworks. I find them extremely valuable and fascinating for architecture. Can they be considered art? Of course, but I want to look at them for architecture's value. Todd, here we go. I was nervous about this one.
You should be.
It's fine.
When are you going to put your cards on the table?
Okay, so meaning what?
Meaning the talk, while impressive in its breadth, impressive in your willingness to kind of take risks,
yeah.
I would say it was divided into two parts. The first part was primarily interpretive and was clouded by footnotes.
Clouded by?
Footnotes.
Oh, sure.
The second part was your video, was a representation of your own installation.
Yeah.
Which was clouded by abstract generalizations. So at the end, in spite of what was a really impressive amount of work and an obvious demonstration of erudition, commitment, dedication, etc., I still found it that at the end of it, I don't know what you're up to. Because every time I saw you about to kind of make a case for as personal as this sounded,
yeah.
You never actually said what you were up to.
Yeah, okay. So, I mean, that's interesting. That's an interesting question, because I mean, I believe me, I'm aware of that to some degree. Like, it's not lost on me. But on one hand, if I'm talking about my own work, I mean, I guess I ended with my own work, but I would talk about it slightly differently, I think. But in talking about a broad subject, like the role of cinematic technique and, you know, time-based media for architecture. I don't have a claim for what it needs to be. I'm saying that's what we each need to do for our own work. Like, we should each be saying what it should be about. Like, in my installations, I was like in the one that you could see the people like working with their hands and bodies in the feedback. I was interested in how you could register space and experience visually. Like, I was really fascinated in that distance between the camera recording something and a screen showing it, and making that absolutely transmissible to the people involved in that context. That as soon as they walked in that moment, they knew they were in a spatial environment implicated by their action, and that action was reflected on the screen before them. And to me, that was quite a powerful moment. So I guess, like, that's the kind of stuff.
But hold on, I mean, the amount of erudition in the first chunk of your lecture guarantees that you know that there's no guarantee that that is true.
What do you mean?
That you're making assumptions about your audience that your own knowledge cannot found.
But I mean, okay, I can't say, like, they are going to immediately know that they're, you know, participating in their context effectively. But what
that
I
is
can,
what you just said.
I was going to finish the thought. But what I think that does is, if I see somebody playing with space, they're doing that. Whether they have like the intellect to like philosophically claim like how that matters on like a larger disciplinary conversation, that's a different thing. But I think that triggering that kind of awareness within somebody by them playing it, by playing with their environment within their context, to me that's an important moment. I mean, I'm super fascinated in the context of play in general. So, like, you know, traditionally there's two types of play, ludus and padaya. Ludus is play for the sake of succeeding at rules. Padaya is play for the sake of play. It's like a child playing in the sand. The way I think about the installation on that was playing in the bubble of light, that to me is padaya. And I get excited when I see that happening in an environment.